The previous Ford program have attempted to tell the story of South Africa sequentially, since humans first entered the territory of the future country about 100,000 years ago, even earlier, when their pre-human ancestors arrived there. But most of the attention has been on the last 350 years, the time since white settlement began as portrayed here, 200 years after the event, by the Cape Town artist Charles Davidson Bell. The people who met the Dutch here on the beach at Table Bay were themselves descendants of people who in centuries past had arrived from outside the country, but by land from the north. They had brought with them a more complex economy than that practiced by even earlier inhabitants, whose best hunting lands they occupied. Later, as we saw, came people who planted as well as herded and hunted. Their knowledge included the smelting of iron they took from others, what they wanted, until they, in turn, were subjugated by descendants of the 17th century seaborne arrivals, who took control of the land and forced the descendants of earlier settlers to labor for them. These people were hardly the first to assume that their primacy would go on indefinitely. But as we saw in the previous episode, it didn't. The South African colored artist and poet Peter Clark, who had once painted the four boys carrying fodder bags, after white rule came to an end, set this poem in paint. Fuleya means muzzle loader. Skustach means excuse me. Previously, we saw that people who had been barred from choosing their rulers for the first time in 1994, chose them. Who were these new rulers? Unlike the all-white male governments which they replaced, there were among them women, black, white, colored, and Indian, serving as cabinet ministers, speakers of the National Assembly, and other positions at all levels of government. South Africa's new rulers were far down the economic ladder from the slave-owning landowners, merchants, and lawyers who ran America's government after the American Revolution. Almost alone among the new African cabinet ministers in having a private source of income was a princess of the Pondo royal family. Those like Mandela, who had once earned a professional degree, in his case law, had long had no chance to practice their professions and earn a livelihood. Several had spent years or decades in prison. Others had scraped by. Many had returned from years of opposition work in exile, during which they had subsisted on small stipends provided by the Soviet Union and the governments of other communist and non-aligned countries. Political office would put bread on the table, but a successful campaign had to be run first. Where would the money come from to acquire and staff from scratch a headquarters building for the African National Congress in Johannesburg, hundreds of offices throughout the country, and all the varied expenses of conducting a national campaign? The Libyan dictator Muammar al-Gaddafi was a principal contributor. Mandela, released from prison, visited him and returned with $40 million for the ANC. Here, they appear in front of Gaddafi's residential compound destroyed by a U.S. airstrike in 1986. To the United States' expressed disapproval of the visit to Libya, Mandela, who was then and would continue to be included on the U.S. government's list of terrorists until 2008, responded, "This is my friend. he helped us at a time when we were all alone, when those who are now saying we should not come here were helping our enemies. $60 million were also obtained for the ANC's 1994 election campaign from Indonesian dictator Suharto. He was responsible for more than 500,000 deaths during the anti-communist purge that brought him to power, plus 100,000 more deaths during Indonesia's invasion and occupation of East Timor. Mandela refrained from criticizing Gaddafi's and Suharto's human rights records. After the ANC had won the election and controlled the government and foreign policy, South Africa backed them both in international forums. The two dictators were awarded South Africa's highest honor. In Suharto's case, a state visit, a 21-gun salute, and the Order of Good Hope, gold class. Unlike democracies such as the United States, which paid brutal dictators in cash, weapons, and other benefits to promote U.S. interests, in this case the money flow went from dictatorships to the new South African democracy. Still more cash was needed to launch the ANC as a viable political party. One willing local donor was a former generous supporter of the apartheid government, the hotel magnate Saul Kirzner. Sun City was the name of one of Kirzner's resort gambling properties, and the topic of an anti-apartheid rock album entitled Sun City, with tracks by Bruce Springsteen, Bono, and other performers who call themselves Artists United Against Apartheid. But Kirzner hit a snag en route to building an empire of hotel properties in South Africa, Mauritius, the Bahamas, Dubai, and the Mohegan Sun Gambling Resort in Connecticut, now one of the two largest gaming and entertainment resorts in the United States. While apartheid was still functioning, he had invested $600,000 in bribing the leaders of one of the South African puppet states, Transkei. The payment was for permission to extend his casino gambling operations into their impoverished territory and keep other casinos out. His expected customers were day trippers from South Africa, where casinos were not permitted. But Bantu Holomisa, a Transkeian army officer, ousted the Transkei government and had bribery charges prepared against Kirzner. Before the first democratic election, with the ANC readying its campaign and seeking funds everywhere, Kirzner met with Mandela. The wind was now blowing in a different direction than in years past. According to press reports, Kirzner paid for a sumptuous wedding and honeymoon for Mandela's daughter Zinzi and her husband. Among favors reportedly bestowed on other ANC officials, Kirzner also paid for a lavish party to celebrate the 50th birthday of soon-to-be deputy president, later president, Thabo Mbeki. Mandela and Kirzner would become lifelong friends. Prior to the election in 1994, Kirzner gave Mandela 2 million rand, these 2 million for the ANC's coffers, while requesting that Mandela speak to Holomisa about the criminal proceedings pending against him in the Transkei. After the ANC came to power and reintegrated Transkei into South Africa, the charges against Kirzner were dropped. Yet, cash flows were insufficient to prevent the ANC being left with a post-election overdraft of several millions. Besides 1,200 full-time staff who had to be provided for at the Johannesburg headquarters, there were party offices to be maintained all over the country. Where would the money come from, considering that much of the party's base lived off a dollar or two a day? What would donors expect to be given in exchange? The ANC campaigned under a powerful slogan. 18 parties entered the contest. The ANC won almost two-thirds of the national vote, along with 7 of the 9 provinces and most municipalities. most voters were entitled to vote for the first time. Men and women, few who had ever owned a bank account, now prepared to take office at all levels of government. They were faced with a traumatized country. Just in the previous 4 years, between Mandela's release from prison in 1990 and the 1994 election, 16,022 persons had died from political violence. After the election, political killings had largely ceased. But, according to a UN survey, South Africa's murder rate at the time was second highest in the world. In rapes per capita, it led the world. All forms of violent crime were increasing. A middle-class white family's garden wall. Nelson Mandela's appeal at the end of his inauguration speech to black and white, "Let us forget the past. What is done," was a wish. It could not confine to the past the violent effects stemming from the profit-driven migrant labor system, with its deliberate grouping of urban African workers away from their families in single-sex hostels for months on end. The past was not done with. And the new men and women at the helm could not help registering the spreading, death-dealing plague that had unexpectedly appeared. An ever-darkening cloud over the horizon of liberation, HIV/AIDS. One-third of the country's working-age population was unemployed. How would the new rulers deal with that? Or with the fact that white governments had spent 8 times more on the education of each white child as on each black child? Pay scales for similarly qualified public servants were differentiated according to race. Ending this involved far more than merely repealing the old laws. A vast expenditure increase would be required, for public service was the country's largest field of employment. Besides teachers, there were nurses, doctors, policemen, all workers on the national railways, municipal employees, university professors, and many other kinds of public servants. Where to find the money to create single pay scales from the 4 racially differentiated pay scales for whites, Indians, coloreds, and Africans without reducing the whites' compensation, but by bringing the other levels up? And where was the money to make good on the ANC's promise to build every year 300,000 new houses and provide all South Africans with clean water, sanitation, electricity? The ANC intended to redistribute back to Africans 30% of the country's land. However, the agreements that had ended apartheid peacefully provided not only that white civil servants would be secure in their jobs, incomes, and pensions, but that land taken from Africans by white governments could only be restored to the original owners or their descendants on a willing buyer, willing seller basis. Thus, the promised land restitution would cost billions. But the economy was not healthy. During the last decade of apartheid, living standards had fallen an average of 10%. Population had grown 5 times faster than goods and services had been produced, leaving less to go around. To save apartheid, the last white governments had borrowed heavily. Squadrons of jet fighters and other new armaments had been purchased for the border wars. Other borrowing from South African banks and insurance companies and foreign creditors had helped to finance South Africa's successful development and production of nuclear weapons. Also, there was the bill to be paid for the former white government's expenditures to build a black supportive constituency for apartheid in the 9 impoverished reserves. So-called independent countries had been set up with new presidents, teams of legislators, and civil servants, effectively on South Africa's payroll. To foster the pretense of independence, these Bantustans were provided with impressive public buildings, in some cases with European-built international airports, equipped with snowplows so as to meet European standards, although no international flights ever landed and no snow fell. Now, these Bantustans were to be reincorporated within a unitary South Africa. No further need, therefore, for separate ministries handling posts, nor for multiples of every other government department. But the new democratic government had to come up with billions of dollars in early retirement packages and pensions for the former Bantustan officials and civil servants. This obligation had been accepted at the negotiations leading to the end of white rule. The ANC had agreed to assume in full the huge government debt that had accumulated to finance the operation and defense of apartheid. The new rulers would have to borrow money just to pay the interest on this debt, leaving that much less to meet the promise of a better life for all. How to deal with the huge economic problems left behind by the apartheid regime? Here, Mandela deferred to his colleagues. He himself worked to convert his prestige into benefit for the country by frequent trips overseas to encourage foreign investment. At home, racial reconciliation was his main thrust. He had closed his inaugural address with an unscripted call on South Africans to forget the past. He worked to set examples, had lunch with a prosecutor who had had him sentenced to life imprisonment, took to dinner the commandant of the Robben Island prison, joined the congregation at an Afrikaner church, traveled to a remote settlement to see the widow of the principal architect of apartheid, visited at his home the country's last white supremacist president, and most famously in 1995, wearing the colors of the Springboks, the South African then still nearly all-white national rugby team strode onto the field following the team's World Cup victory over New Zealand to shake the hand of its captain, Francois Pienaar. Until then, the few Africans who had bothered to show up in the penned-off stadium section allocated to them under apartheid had cheered every opponent of the Springboks. But this time, prior to the opening kick, the Springbok players, most of them Afrikaners, sang the old African resistance hymn, now part of the new national anthem. The Springboks' victory and the Mandela-Pienaar handshake set off a countrywide celebration. Mandela, now no longer a prisoner, was a world-honored statesman. Gestures of forgiveness and reconciliation could more easily come to him. But for most of the unknown men and women preparing to take seats in municipal councils and in parliament, how could the past be forgotten? Yes, now, at last, laws applied to all, equally. But the new lawmakers knew that mass poverty with which they now had to deal had been engineered deliberately to enrich many of those now wealthy. The cost of living of their ancestors, crowded after the white conquest into a few scattered reserves, had been intentionally raised through a tax payable in cash. The purpose of taxing people who had no money was to transform them from self-sufficient subsistence farmers into a cheap labor force. To get the money for the tax, thus escape imprisonment, the able-bodied men accepted recruitment on long-term contracts for work on distant white-owned mines, farms, and factories at wage terms set by employers. Anti-strike laws, enforced by the police, kept wages where employers wanted them to remain. The depth of black poverty and the extent of white wealth were no accidents. With the apartheid debt having to be repaid, the former administrators of apartheid to be pensioned off, and existing property rights not to be abridged, how much could be done to help those damaged by what had happened in the past? Mandela left it to his principal deputy, later president, Thabo Mbeki, to lead a group of retired exiles and former street organizers to determine what was to be done. Mbeki had been out of the country for 28 years. During this time, he had earned university degrees in economics in Britain and had been selected as his principal aide by the ANC's president in exile, Oliver Tambo. Mbeki had argued for talks with the apartheid regime in the 1980s, when many in the ANC were still preoccupied with the impossible dream of overthrowing the white government militarily. When talks with the white government did begin, he supported the painful but essential compromise that transferred political power to blacks at the cost of leaving existing property ownership rights, the basis of the economic status quo, intact. Yet a better life for all had been promised. 1 million houses were to be built within 5 years. 50 to 60 liters of clean water per person per day were to be supplied from a point no more than 200 meters from each dwelling. Access to sanitation, electricity, health services, and education was to be rapidly increased, and 30% of the land was to be purchased and redistributed to Africans. A massive public works program to relieve unemployment was promised. But before any of this could go forward, the interest due on the national debt had to be paid. As immediate was the negotiated obligation to begin streaming pension payments to the thousands of civil servants losing jobs related to the administration of apartheid, and other thousands who had worked in the government services of the former so-called Bantu homelands. Simultaneously, the racial inequities in the public sector in pensions and pay could not continue, no matter how costly it would be to terminate them. A portion of the revenue required for these many tasks would come from redirecting government expenditures. Thus, the defense budget, after a one-time boost to pay the costs of integrating the ANC's guerrilla forces with the former apartheid forces, was then cut 3 years in succession. The discontinuance of the so-called independent Bantu homeland governments meant that the subsidies formerly paid to them could now be applied to other needs. But these savings amounted to a mere fraction of the cost of the electoral promises made by the ANC. Then, what was to be the way forward? Answering this question would have been difficult enough were the liberation movement's leaders agreed on how to proceed, but they were not. The liberation movement was composed principally of three allied constituents: the main body of the ANC, the Congress of South African Trade Unions, and the South African Communist Party. Several trade union leaders and Communist Party members were concurrently members of the ANC and served on its decision-making bodies. They also maintained their separate organizations. The Congress of South African Trade Unions, with nearly 2 million members, was the largest of the country's trade union federations, while the South African Communist Party, with more than 50,000 members, was the largest of Africa's few remaining communist parties. That rifts would emerge and deepen after liberation seems inevitable, as everywhere in the world, the issue centered on the allocation of scarce resources. The needs and wants of the unionized workers clashed with the needs of the millions of unemployed living on less than $2 a day. Union leaders strove to protect their own jobs and their members' jobs by pressing leaders of the new government to stick with the former apartheid government's high tariff policy, with the result of keeping what otherwise would have been cheaper Asian imports, including footwear and clothing, priced out of reach for millions of their poorer fellow citizens. The unionized workers pushed for wider application of minimum wage rules and for stronger legal safeguards against job dismissal. Achieving these objectives would make it harder for the unemployed to find jobs because employers would be unable to make new hires at less than minimum wage and would have to keep new hires on payroll even if they didn't work out. By October of 1995, 20 months after the advent of democracy in South Africa, only 10,600 of the targeted 125,000 new houses had been built. Meanwhile, 400,000 new job seekers had come onto the market, but only 30,000 new jobs. To make up for the huge shortfall in private sector job creation, union leaders and communists agreed that a massive public works program was essential. The money for it would have to be borrowed, irrespective of the effect on the deficit. The apartheid regime had borrowed from banks and pension funds to finance weapons purchases it thought necessary. Surely, a democratic government should not hesitate to borrow to build houses, sanitation systems, power grids, classrooms, and health clinics. Or were they not investments in the future? Other essential financing should come by raising income tax rates on the chief beneficiaries of racial discrimination, the well-to-do and corporations, people who took clean drinking water for granted. But Deputy President Thabo Mbeki was formulating the new government's economic policy, not leaders of the union federations, nor communists, nor spokesmen for the unemployed and poor. Mbeki was the son of a communist liberation hero who had been sentenced, together with Mandela, to life imprisonment for terrorism and treason, and had served with Mandela on Robben Island. Thabo Mbeki himself, until recently, had been a member of the seven-person Politburo of the South African Communist Party, and was heir to the socialist principles which the ANC would commemorate on a monument. But he had concluded during his 28 years of exile that a government basing its policy on socialist principles wouldn't last. The regime of Salvador Allende in Chile was a case in point. Allende had come to power in the peak year of a depression on a promise to uplift the lives of the unemployed and the poor. To increase consumer spending and boost employment, prices were frozen. Wage increases were instituted, and public works programs launched. Banks and heavy industries were nationalized. Higher income Chileans were required to pay higher taxes. For 1 year, Allende's policies appeared to be successful. Industrial output rose sharply and unemployment fell, but only up to the moment that Allende's government ran out of money. Thereafter, to pay its bills and meet payrolls, it simply printed currency. The resulting inflation crippled the economy and the streets filled with striking doctors, teachers, students, truck owner drivers, copper miners, small store owners. 3 years after his accession to power, the military replaced Allende with a right-wing dictator. This is the last photo taken of Allende alive. Mbeki absorbed a similar lesson during years of his exile spent in Lusaka, Zambia's capital. There he observed the experience of Zambia's first independent government, led by Kenneth Kaunda. When British colonialism ended, there were but 109 African university graduates in the country. Less than one-half of 1% of the population had completed primary school, and all mining, manufacturing, banking, and major business was controlled by foreigners. Kaunda's independence government nationalized Zambia's copper mines, the country's biggest earner. Copper sales produced a substantial income for the state. This made possible large investments to expand education and to improve health by subsidizing basic foods and by programs such as distributing milk to poor families. But when the price of imported oil shot up at the same time that the world market price for copper fell by a half, the money ran out. The government tried to keep food prices level by taking out loans, their proceeds directed to continue the subsidies to fertilizer producers and farmers. But as the country's indebtedness grew, the interest rate demanded by lenders for each new loan also grew beyond the point of affordability. Zambia, now desperate, like many other countries, went cap in hand to the lender of last resort, the International Monetary Fund in Washington. IMF loans are made on condition the recipient country agreed to change or terminate the policies that brought it to the IMF's doorstep in the first place. Invariably, this meant agreeing to drastic cutbacks in social programs and to apply the money saved to pay off debts. These agreements meant that the debtor government effectively relinquished control to the IMF over its domestic policy. Mbeki and the ANC leadership in Lusaka had watched from the sidelines as Zambian humanism, President Kaunda's official policy, was struck by changes in global market conditions that transformed the country into one of the most indebted in the world. Once the IMF took charge, price controls were ordered ended, and food and fertilizer subsidies were cancelled. Massive increases in the price of basic foodstuffs resulted. The country's urban population rioted in protest. Kaunda's presidency was over. Mbeki concluded that Allende's and Kaunda's way was not the way to go. A more attractive template for running the country and for the presidency to which Mbeki expected to be elected upon Mandela's retirement was Britain's Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher. She had been elected to three successive terms and had enjoyed the longest period of premiership in Britain in almost 200 years. She had taken office in a country also beset with high unemployment, high inflation, and stagnant growth. Her responses were the opposite of the policy that the Congress of South African Trade Unions and the South African Communist Party was urging upon the new ANC government. She cut the social services budget, placed severe legal restrictions on the power of unions, raised interest rates so as to lower inflation, sold off state-owned enterprises, reduced business taxes. For Mbeki, the populist policies of Chile's Allende and Zambia's Kaunda would not be repeated in South Africa. Instead, as heavy a lid as possible would be kept on government spending, though this would mean that millions would have to wait indefinitely for the promised better life. Financing for necessities as clean water supplies for the poor would not be obtained by raising taxes on the well-to-do, principally white, former beneficiaries of apartheid. The ANC's union and communist allies urged the new government to boost marginal tax rates on higher income individuals and corporations. But Mbeki and his colleagues saw it as providing a short-term fix that very soon would be followed by an actual drop in government revenue. Already fearing the violent crime that was spreading from the shanty towns into their own neighborhoods, numbers of whites were emigrating. Higher taxes, adding to their cost of private protection, would simply speed the outflow, bringing about the total loss of the country's investment in the education of the emigrants, from primary school through university, and the disappearance from South Africa of their technical and professional skills and business experience, not to mention the tax revenues they had provided. Human capital flight constituted disinvestment. At the same time, investment was being sought from Mandela's trips overseas. To retain skilled personnel, encourage investment, prevent revenue losses, both individual and corporate taxes, therefore, were reduced. Tax policy was one of the several flashpoints between the new government's leadership and its union and communist allies. The union leaders and communists struggled to prevent Mbeki from raising government revenue by selling off state-owned enterprises to private companies, as Margaret Thatcher had done in Britain. They feared that private owners would shed money-losing divisions, trimming their workforce of dues-paying union members. The ANC government also supported efforts by white-owned banks to foreclose township houses of mortgage defaulters. Nationalization of banks was abandoned as ANC policy, yet it remained engraved on one of the 10 tablets composing the ANC's Freedom Charter monument, dedicated by Mbeki in 2005. Also, the 1955 Freedom Charter had declared, "There shall be houses, security, and comfort for all." So why, unionists and communists asked, the deafening silence that is being shown by the ANC towards the demolition of illegal shantytowns and the forcible eviction of their residents, as had occurred so often in the time of apartheid? In the Western Cape, the dispossessed were relocated to blikkiesdorps, so-called tin can towns, situated 30 miles or more from work sites, with no transportation provided to enable the unemployed to conduct a job search. But Mbeki was focusing on a problem none could have anticipated at the time the Freedom Charter was drafted. Unless the deficit and debt were reduced through a policy of fiscal austerity, the Liberation Government would be unable to avoid either printing money to pay its bills, like Allende had done in Chile, or seeking loans from the IMF, thereby ceding control over domestic policy to foreigners. No government which followed either course could expect to last long. Ironically, to avoid being painted as servants of the International Monetary Fund, Mbeki and his associates put in place policies similar to those the IMF would have required, simply without being instructed to do this by the IMF. Mandela endorsed his deputy's policies. In his first State of the Nation address, Mandela said, quote, "We are determined to make every effort to contain real general government consumption at present levels, and to manage the budget deficit with a view to its continuous reduction. Similarly, we are agreed that a permanently higher general level of taxation is to be avoided." Unquote. Despite Mandela's agreement to push spending for the poor out of first place in order to avert inflation, indebtedness, and control by foreigners, it was Mbeki, not Mandela, who was left to face the music. Probably the most painful of the criticisms flung at Mbeki was shot by his father, the communist liberation hero, who had been sentenced together with Mandela to life imprisonment for terrorism and treason. Govan Mbeki joined those in charging that his son had, quote, rolled over. But what would have been Thabo Mbeki's fate had he led the economy into collapse? Collapse was a real possibility. Soon after the ANC government took over, Moody's Investment Service, one of the two major firms that judge the ability of corporations and governments to pay back what they owe, awarded South Africa a rating just above sub-investment, or junk bond status. To turn this around, to make South Africa attractive to foreign investors, government spending was reduced to a smaller percentage of gross domestic product in 1999, when Mandela retired as president and was succeeded by Mbeki than what it had been in 1994 when the Liberation Government had taken charge. The budget deficit was cut nearly in half. Trade and investment regulations were liberalized, tariffs reduced, corporate taxes lightened, state firms privatized. Subsequently, Moody's and Standard & Poor's granted an investment-grade credit rating to South African commercial and government borrowing. Yet for all that, direct foreign investment came in at a trickle. From year to year, the rate of economic growth, with one temporary upward tick, actually fell, while unemployment, instead of being reduced, rose by more than 1 million persons by 1999 when Mandela left office and Mbeki became titular president. The ANC's business-friendly policy, false in theory in the view of union leaders and the South African Communist Party, also appeared to be a failure in practice. Mbeki's decades of work in exile to bring about liberation and then to preserve the liberated country's economic independence was met by many of the poor neither with gratitude nor understanding as the economy worsened. The sign on the right reads, "We vote for better life, not for worse. We live like pigs." The AWB on the sign at the center refers to a white racist organization which had employed violence in its effort to preserve apartheid. In view of the building opposition to Mbeki's policies, would his supporters remain loyal? What could he do to energize them?